cashless savings bank, you still get personalized customer service.
We have identity-safe checking with LifeLock, identity theft protection.
You get personal mortgage lending to fit your needs now and in the future.
You get business banking with the latest technology, because saving you time saves you money.
At Councilless Savings Bank, you get people who answer when you call and local employees who are actively involved in our community. Councilless Savings Bank, hometown banking the way it used to be.
Please stand and join us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome, everybody. I'd like to call the meeting to order. Show that all council members are here and would entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion?
I'd like to amend the agenda to delete item 6B2.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion on the amendment.
We're just going to hold off on this until the next meeting because there's a little bit of background information, so some more work to be done on this.
Other discussion? All those in favor of the amendment signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. And then any discussion on the consent agenda as amended? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Tonight we have four public hearings. If you would like to address the council in regards to any of those on public hearings, the audience has 10 minutes of time to do that. And so we'll start off with the first one, 4A, which is this is a time and place for a public hearing as advertised on the matter of Resolution 15-196, authorizing the disposal of city property legally described as lots 21 and 23, Nash Subdivision, replat 1. Is proof of publication on file?
It is on file.
Have any written protests been received?
None received.
Is there anyone in the audience wishing to speak to the council on this matter? Seeing none, what is the council's pleasure?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Discussion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. This is a time and place for a public hearing as advertised on the matter of Resolution 15-197, approving the plans, specifications, form of contract, and cost estimate for River's Edge Subdivision Improvement Project Phase 2. Is proof of publication on file?
It is on file.
Have any written protests been received?
None received.
Is there anyone wishing to speak to the council on this matter? If so, please come forward to the podium and give your name and address for the record.
My name is Al Ruby. I live at 513 North 27th Street. On the resolution of 15-197, approving the plans, specifications, forms, and contracts, where's the money coming to improve this?
There are a variety of sources, which include some state funding, some general obligation bonding, some lot sales. We'll get rid of some of the debt associated with the entire project. I'm not sure that that's specifically for this phase, but.
Okay. Are the lot, you mentioned lot sales. Are those lot sales posted? Is there gonna be bids on those lots?
There are, Dick, help me with this, because there is a process we need to go through in disposing of public property. But you would have to have a project. You just couldn't buy the lot to block the development. Okay, so.
Right. There would, anytime we dispose of an interested property, we have to have a public hearing. And prior to that public hearing, we set notice of that public hearing. So it would be a two-reading process. And sometimes these agreements to sell will be included within development agreements.
Okay, I appreciate that. But the reason why I'm asking is when this property goes up for sale, or if it's got, they've got a project that can go in there, such as, I don't know what kind of development it is, I haven't really seen it. But everybody should have a chance to get this, am I correct?
In theory, you could come and propose a project and pay the price of the lot, yes.
Okay. You know, the prices of the lots, are those listed?
I don't know that they are yet. I don't remember if we've exactly replatted it yet. I'm sure they haven't.
Okay. And are any of those residential?
They would be residential from the aspect that they're multifamily residential.
Okay, so are they infills?
No, they're apartments, multifamily's okay. Apartments.
Apartments only?
Yeah.
Okay.
There is some townhomes in a later phase.
Okay. And the reason why I'm asking is because there's other contractors that are interested, and we have talked about this, and they were concerned, and I'm not just speaking for them, but they were concerned that they had an opportunity to have a right to come up with a plan for low income and residential, you know, housing for these people. So I just, you answered my question, and I appreciate
these that. Would be market rate apartments and not single family residential.
Okay. Thank you.
And there are agreements already with developers where the concept for development has already been laid out in some detail, and that has previously been voted on in concept by the council. So there's already a well-developed concept for the proposal that's already been put together by this developer.
Who's a developer?
There are multiple developers.
Who are they?
There's a general developer, probably not the right term, but the apartment developer would be Broadmoor.
And they out of Iowa or out of Council Bluffs?
They're out of Omaha, but they have properties in Council Bluffs. They have apartments around Dodge Park. Those are all Broadmoor properties. The Riverview Apartments, I think they call them.
Has any of this been ever offered to any of the contractors in Council Bluffs?
Yes. It was a project that's probably 10 years in the making that they took development bids twice at least, and I think three times if you consider the one guy who was going to put high-rise condominiums there and failed to do that. So.
And who was the head of the development?
Who was the head of the development?
Yeah, who was in charge of the development on this property?
Well, the City of Council Bluffs owns the property, and they did an RFP, which stands for Request for Proposal, from the development market. And okay. I believe four different developers responded to that the second time. I can't okay. tell you how many did the first time.
Okay. Thank you. I appreciate it.
And that was after, too, it went out for a request for qualifications.
Yeah.
You had to meet those.
Yeah. Anybody else wish to address the council in regards to this matter? Is there a motion from the council?
Motion to approve the resolution.
Second.
Any discussion?
You know, this is a fantastic. I hope everybody's had a chance to go online and look at the plans or to read it in the paper. But it's a great plan to bring more life to the west end of Council Bluffs, our front door. It's one of two things tonight we're going to be talking about, the west end. It's a fantastic project for today and the future, and I encourage you to go look at it. And I wholeheartedly endorse it. It's just phenomenal what it'll do for our people and for the tax base. I can't speak more highly of it, and there's been a lot of work that's gone into it. And so I do want to thank the mayor for all of the necessary work. There's quite a bit of it. A lot of it's not glamorous with the paperwork and the underlying putting together the project, but it's phenomenal, and I want to thank him for.
I facetiously said this afternoon that we'd be seeing the developer 50 more times. I think Don calculated from initiation to completion there will be 52 separate actions that will come before this council associated with this project. So,
well, it's a great mix of commercial business, commercial retail, or commercial office, commercial retail, and residential opportunities, and it'll really change the look of the west view of Council Bluffs. I think it's fantastic. I can't wait until Earth starts moving.
Yeah, I'm really excited about it. We need this type of development. I do like the mix, and I think the one thing it also brings that we don't have in Council Bluffs right now is we don't have any Class A plus office space. So when we're looking to attract corporate offices, home offices, you know, where corporate offices will locate their major home offices, we don't have anything to offer them. And we do get calls. Economic development does get calls, but we just don't have that product in Council Bluffs. So, you know, it's my hope then that we will start seeing some other businesses locate their headquarters here. And I'm still very excited about the amount of tax base that'll be added. Those are the things we need to do in order to help keep taxes low. So, yep.
I have previously expressed my reservations about this based upon the extensive financial obligation that's being committed to this at a time when we're just beginning on the West Broadway redevelopment plans, and I question putting this, making those sorts of commitments for this particular project before we really have any idea of what the cost of the West Broadway redevelopment will be in the long term. So those reservations remain.
Any further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Nay.
This is time and place for a public hearing as advertised on the matter of Resolution 15-198, approving the plans, specifications, and form of contract for the Broadway Shelter Improvement Project. Is proof of publication on file?
It is on file.
Have any written protests been received?
None received.
Is there anyone wishing to speak to the council? If so, please come forward to the podium and give your name and address for the record. Is there a, seeing none, is there a motion?
Motion to approve the resolution.
Second.
Any discussion?
I just want to briefly say, as far as I'm aware, this is the last building left standing in the entire metro area that is original to the old Omaha Council Bluffs Trolley Company, which was an instrumental part of our history in this community. And this is a way of repurposing, is the word, repurposing an old building so it'll stick around. And in this case, for a very good purpose, to help with free and reduced lunches for kids during the summer so that they can get out of the elements. And I can't think of a better way to preserve history than something good like that.
Well, it's also a great partnership. About 46% of the funds to improve that and to save that building are from various donated sources, and 54% from the city. So it's just really shows that working together, we can together save a very unique building.
Any further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. This time and place for a public hearing is advertised on the matter of Resolution 15-199, granting final plat approval for a three-lot subdivision to be known as Evans Subdivision, being a replat of lots 31 through 34, and all the vacated Michigan Avenue, all of vacated Michigan Avenue lying east of South 11th Street, and abutting said lots, and lots 53 through 68, in the south half of vacated Michigan Avenue lying north of and adjacent to lots 53 through 56, all in Ramona Subdivision, except parts of lots 60 and 61 adjacent to South 11th Street. Is proof of publication on file?
It is on file.
Have any written protests been received?
None received.
Is there anyone wishing to speak to the council on this matter? If so, please come forward to the podium and give your name and address for the record. Seeing none, is there a motion from the council?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Madam Clerk.
Resolutions. Resolution 15-200, authorizing the mayor to execute an order accepting the acknowledgement settlement agreement from GasMart USA Incorporated, DBA Eddies, number 503, located at 503 9th Avenue, for a violation of Iowa Code Section 453A.2, Parent 1.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign.
Resolution 15-201, authorizing the mayor to execute a RISE agreement by and between the City of Council Bluffs and the Iowa Department of Transportation for the grant award of $1,909,539 for the improvements in Rivers Edge subdivision.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion?
This is a, just briefly, this is a good example of money that's coming from the state, primarily in the end your income tax money. That's nearly $2 million that's going to new roads on in the West End at the entrance to our community, that if the $2 million didn't go there, it'd go to some other community. So I'm glad we got it.
Road use tax money.
Road use, yeah.
Not income.
Income, excuse me. Wrong one. Thank you.
Yeah.
And as with many times, when you make an agreement with the state or another jurisdiction to use their money, usually it comes with strings attached. If anybody is having insomnia, I would invite you to pull up the agreement here in question. You'll be cured very quickly, but there are obligations that attach with that. So just keep that in mind. No money is ever free.
Any additional discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Resolution 15-202, authorizing the mayor and city clerk to execute an agreement with Valley Corporation Incorporated for the Rivers Edge Subdivision Improvement Project Phase 1.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Is there any discussion?
I just want to make a comment. This is 1, 2, 3, 4. There's 5 items on the agenda tonight that are that involve awarding bids. And in the write-up, you see that there's a bid versus an engineer's estimate. And this one in particular is 11.6% over the estimate. The next one coming up was about 17% below the estimate. The next one is 4.5% below the estimate, and then the final one is 11%. Above the estimate. So it's just an indication of the bidding environment and some of the expertise of some of the bidders. City does a pretty good job of estimating what the probable cost would be. We don't always hit it 100%. Sometimes we're over, sometimes we're under, and you'll see that evident tonight.
In this particular case, the next lowest bid came in at about $700,000. More than the bid that we're accepting here. There are a variety of reasons for that. As was pointed out, there is a cost overrun on that, and we're experiencing that increasingly across the city. Anytime we get into projects that compete for construction, engineering, for concrete, for those sorts of things. So we can probably anticipate that there are going to be cost overruns in future contract bids, to including phase 2 of this particular development project. So may need to go back to the well for additional general obligation bonding. Remains to be seen, but we'll see when that bidding process goes forward.
The great thing about the market and the costs being higher right now, supply and demand, that means a lot of people are working. Contractors are working again for the first time in years. And though I don't like overruns, you know, 10-11% overrun and lots of people have work, well, there's a cost for things, and I'd rather have it be that way than the other.
And at least not all the bids were over. Some of them were under.
Fair so enough. That's so You're that's quite right. Point, yeah. Some of them were under mm-hmm. by that amount and more as well, like yeah. you pointed out. Thank you.
I think we're seeing more and more bids where anything to do with dirt or concrete.
Yes. Yeah.
They're running high, so which means that the dirt haulers and the concrete people are busy, and that's a great thing.
And just for point of clarification on bonding, when we do that bonding, we would have to delineate what the use of the bonding was. And you can bond before you start a project, but you have to start that project within a certain time frame. I think, is it 6 months or 18 months? I can't. 6 months. And so we really can't get into it and go back later and rebond to add more to it. So we just would have to find other financing sources. So, Madam Clerk?
We need a vote.
Oh, I'm sorry. Any other discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign.
That's nay.
Why the clerks? And
Resolution 15-203, authorizing the mayor and city clerk to execute an agreement with Judd's Brothers Construction Company for the 3rd Street Sewer Relocation Project.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign.
Resolution 15-204, amending the Bluffs Tomorrow 2030 Plan, Comprehensive Plan, through the adoption and incorporation of the West Broadway Corridor Plan.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Discussion.
If folks go to, I just checked a little bit ago, and the website still links you to the correct city page. West Broadway in Motion, all one word, no dashes or periods, westbroadwayinmotion.com. You'll be able to see every draft of this plan, including the one we're voting on tonight. It is a general plan. It's not the nitty-gritty of all the details, but you'll notice that this plan took into account public comment. I know there's been a lot of concern about the median, and I just wanted to briefly say that right now, for the roughly three miles of West Broadway west of the viaduct, there's a median that goes every square foot of it, even where a left turn isn't needed. And what this plan does in response to public feedback is puts in beautiful medians where a left turn is not needed. It's not a boulevard where it's blocking left turns completely along the whole way. It took directly into account your comments and your input. It's a fantastic plan, and I encourage you to go look at it, because this is the sort of thing that, you know, our kids and grandkids will want to stay in our community for. There were several decades where a lot of folks wouldn't necessarily, everybody stayed, but more and more people are now, and it's things like this that keeps them here. And it's just a fantastic project.
And it was great to see, we comment second, don't we? The public comments.
Did I comment out of turn?
No, we're on resolution.
If someone from the public wants to come to the podium, you can do it. There's 5 minutes.
Oh, I apologize.
No, I think it's okay. Wasn't a public hearing. Same strategy, Al. You got to give your name and address.
Public hearing. I think it's okay.
Same procedure, name and address for the record, please.
Al Ruby, 513 North 27th Street, Council Bluffs. A lot of people in the area that I live in, of course, I live in the West End, they're also wondering where the money's coming for this, too. And is it part of the state? Is the state providing some of this money? Is there bonding going on?
Well, at this point, it is a preliminary plan, and so no money has been committed other than the money associated with producing the plan. We are in initial conversations with the Department of Transportation. Broadway is Highway 6. And currently is maintained by the Department of Transportation. There is no storm sewer on Broadway. There are storm inlets at the corners, and they run north-south. So at the corner, you'll see a storm inlet that may run to Avenue A or may run to 2nd Avenue. But in the middle of the block, and some blocks are extremely long, for example, TJ, you'll see no storm sewers the entire length of TJ. What that does is cause water to pool and stand for a while. When traffic hits it, it splashes on the building, causes freeze-thaw cycle with the sidewalk, causes building deteriorate, look bad. And so we would like to rebuild Broadway. The Department of Transportation would like to do what they call a TJ, transfer of jurisdiction of Highway 6 as it stands within the corporate limits of the city of Council Bluffs. And they are proposing to pay us enough money to build that street new, and on our dime would come the cost of the storm sewer, because there currently is not storm sewer. So if we want to put in storm sewer, we'd have to pay for that. The estimated cost from the river to 16th Street is about $20 million. The Iowa Department of Transportation is willing to give us that money. Storm sewer is about $4 million. We'd have to program that in our capital improvement plan to put that in, so it'd be done over time. And then we still need to resolve how we pay the maintenance costs, because as we said earlier, the state has different revenue sources, one of which is road use tax, the tax you pay on gasoline. And the city gets a specified amount based on its population. And so if we take over Broadway, we would need to hire at least two new employees and maybe three, and we would need to supply them with additional equipment. The Public Works Street Division has estimated that cost somewhere between $400,000 and $500,000 a year. The Department of Transportation says they'll do the first year's maintenance. We're going to go back and try and negotiate multiple years of maintenance expense for that as part of the transfer of jurisdiction, so that in that time our population could grow and help pay for that cost. The improvements that Nate talked about, the aesthetic improvements, fancy streetlights, plantings would be paid for, we think, through a grant from the Iowa West Foundation, and they're willing to do that. We have been buying properties over the last 5 or 6 years as a result of generous gifts from specific benefactors, and we have bought the Razzle Dazzle, Paul's Motorcycle, Con's Drugs, and we're soon to buy all the Echo electric properties. And so we have multiple parcels of ground that are shovel ready for development. And we think the culmination of all three of those things can make a rapid and dramatic change in the appearance of West Broadway. And I think the linchpin of all that is the Playland project and its success. If that becomes successful, West Broadway gets looked at a lot differently than it is today. One additional thing is the Department of Transportation will add a full interchange off Interstate 29 at 41st Street on Broadway. And so you'll be able to access Broadway from four directions, to Omaha from Omaha, to Council Bluffs from Council Bluffs. We'll make it easier to access, which makes it more attractive for development. So actually, from a local perspective, if I'm doing my math right, it's that maintenance cost that we currently don't have now that's in the neighborhood of about $500,000 a year would be the cost to the local taxpayer. Again, we're going to try and negotiate a little better deal with the Department of Transportation. If things develop, we pick up new tax base that helps defray that. If the population grows because of apartment complexes, we get more road use tax money, and so.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying. I'm sure everybody in this room knows that Broadway needs to be redone. It's been in bad shape for years. And there's things that happen on Broadway that I couldn't understand why the city did, by wasting money, by putting brick down when they know that it was gonna go bad. And what's going on with that is another story. My biggest concern is
you're right, it is, and I'll tell you the other story. All that brick's paid for by the Iowa West Foundation. The first time it deteriorated and weeds grew up through it, I asked the Iowa West Foundation to use stamped concrete so that there wouldn't be gaps for weeds to grow up. The Iowa West Foundation said, we're happy to replace it, but we're gonna do it in brick. They paid for it, the taxpayer didn't. They got about as far as Hy-Vee when this proposal came forward from the state to sell the property. And so at that point really didn't make sense to continue replacing the brick if you're just gonna tear it up next year and rebuild Broadway. But taxpayer didn't pay for any of that brick, and the city didn't do it, Iowa West did.
So. Well, my biggest concern too, and not just me, but people that I live in the area with, is what's this gonna do to our taxes? You know, when the casinos come in, they said our taxes wasn't gonna go up. And my taxes have doubled since I've lived in my home. And I understand we gotta go with a flow. You know, your taxes are gonna go up, you got prices of things going up, but it just seems like the city just keeps doing all this stuff and they're buying all this property up, and we understand we want to make Council Bluffs better than what it is, but it's the citizens that are paying for this. We elected you folks to sit on this board to handle our money, and a lot of us feel that our money's being thrown out the window, and you guys are not handling it like it should be. And we're tired of our taxes going up. There's issues with this, and we don't understand why things like this are happening. How much input has been put into this? I mean, I realize you guys got these diagrams.
Well, we had at least four public forums that were attended by thousands of city employees that were well advertised. And I get that people's taxes have gone up. I would tell you that in the last 11 years, and we've had this conversation before, so I don't know how many times I need to tell you this, but in the last 11 years, is averaged slightly more than 1% annually, when the Midwest cost of living has gone up higher than that. Now, if the value of your home has gone up, you need to thank these council members, because it is your most significant asset, at least it's mine, and if the decisions they've made end up ultimately increasing the value of your home, I think they're doing you a justice.
What a statement that I received, and not just me, but a lot of people received. The taxes went up, but the prices of the houses went down. And everybody's going to say, well, it's real estate. Well, I don't believe that.
The state's rollback was part of that. You know, we have not raised our levy. So it's been over 8 years since the city has raised your levy. Now, the county raised your levy. The state changed your rollback. But none of those things were anything that this council could do anything about. I mean, we have no control over those things. This council has been really, really good stewards of your money. When you have increases every single year in every cost, including gasoline that the city has to use for their trucks, in insurance for the employees, everybody's insurance has gone up every year. All those costs go up, and yet the city's been able to manage to not raise that mill. I think has been phenomenal. And my taxes went up too, but I know that my taxes went up because my rollback changed, because the county raised their taxes. The school board, you know, they control a very large portion of what your taxes are. The city controls what percentage? It's very
last year. Last year, and I think it may have changed this year because they took the mental health off the county's portion. Mm-hmm. The city was the third highest tax collector as a percentage of Council Bluffs citizens' taxes. The schools were number one. 2 years ago, the county surpassed the city. I think this year, I don't know if it's 18 months in arrears, they will turn around, and I think the city will pass them again. And the reason that is the state regionalized mental health care, and it was about a 20, do you know what it was, 24 cents. You're kind of in that business a little bit. The savings to the county taxpayers was 24 cents per thousand, yeah. I think, because of the regionalization of the mental health. Yeah. And so we may jump back over the county in the next tax cycle, but they haven't raised the levy. That doesn't mean that the amount of money they raise hasn't gone up, because valuations have gone up. The key to keeping taxes reasonable is to grow the property tax base. And I told you this last time, you can not grow the property tax base, and that would mean you have to do two things: lay people off and cut services to the citizens, which sounds good in theory, never plays well once it happens, or you raise people's property taxes to make up for the lack of valuation increase. And so you can do three things: increase the value, cut services, or raise people's taxes. And by doing things like this, that raises the overall valuation and spreads out the property tax burden amongst more payers and helps control the increase. And I'm not going to tell you there wasn't an increase, because that would not be a fair statement. But I think that, like I say, I've gone back and done the math. On average, it's slightly more than 1% a year, when the Midwest cost of living goes up 2.8 probably annually over that same time frame. So they're almost a third. The amount of taxes went up that funds the same things that residents pay for their homes.
gas, salaries, insurance, those things, we've been able to do at almost a third of the cost of the Midwest cost of living, which I think is pretty prudent.
I just hope that you know, when this does happen, this occurs, that the people that are living today are not going to be stuck with a bunch of taxes that they can't afford to have, you know, pay out and lose their homes. Yeah. Because there's a lot of people out there because of things that the city's doing.
Been doing it for 20 years myself. Haven't seen that happen in 20 years. Can't promise you what's going to happen 20 years from now.
But I would also encourage you as a taxpayer to pose that question to the other taxing bodies who have a great impact on what you pay, the county and the school board. I really hope that you do that.
All right, thank you.
So folks at home understand a reference was made to rollback, which refers to changes occasioned by property tax reform in the legislature. Those changes in rollback, while on their face would mean decreased revenue to the city, thus far the legislature has been reimbursing that rollback, so the city has not been losing any significant revenue as a result of that.
Rollback for the commercial. Now, yeah. The rollback on the residential actually, until 2005, rolled back when I started on the council. I think it was 78% of the valuation. It rolled back as low as 47 or something. So what that means, if your home's valued at 100,000, you're only paying taxes on 47,000 of that 100,000. And residential and agricultural are tied together. Agricultural is not a market value, it's a productivity value. Farms got very profitable from 2005 until last year. And so it drug upwards the amount of taxable valuation of your home. By law, state law, it was 4%. 2 years ago, they changed it to 3% increase as the maximum increase. So it went up, and I think it's about 57% now. So it's the valuation that's taxable has gone up 10%. And so a $100,000 home, you pay taxes today on $57,000 of it. But I would tell you that agricultural productivity has taken a dramatic turn the other direction. And so I think you're going to start seeing the rollback again begin to roll back. So it's a state formula. And really, to complicate it even further, then every 4 years they come in and do what they call an equalization. And they assess, if the assessor has 10 properties and the average is 100,000 and on average they're selling for 110,000, they raise everybody's valuation 10%. So it's confusing and very difficult to understand, but that's what we're faced with.
Well, going back to the plan that we'll vote on here shortly, I want to say that, you know, I attended a couple of the public meetings, and I really want to commend the citizens of Council Bluffs for coming forward, giving your opinions. The plan has morphed and changed through this process. Based on the comments that were received, and even the last public meeting, which was at Community Hall a couple months ago, additional changes to the plan happened because of the comments that the people attending that meeting that night provided. So it really was you talk about West Broadway in motion, this was a plan in motion that was continually changing based on the residents' input, and because we're the ones that we'll be driving Broadway and either benefiting from the commercial retail development and the housing. Senior housing was an important issue, and that's included in the plan. So I think it's a great blueprint of how we move forward and what will shape Broadway, which is one of the biggest main entrance to our city. And it's gonna have a completely different look. It'll be great.
If we do nothing with West Broadway, eventually, I can all but guarantee, I'd bet my life on it, that we will get gifted West Broadway. And I know that because I mentioned this afternoon, I spent much of my childhood in Underwood, and so used to drive every day 191, especially as a teenager. The county was offered a good deal to have it rebuilt with state money, not your local property tax money. The county didn't take that deal. The state eventually said, you get to get this road with no money. So if you notice, the reason why it's not called 191 until you get just south of Tri-Center at the Harrison County line is it's not a state road within the county. You're paying completely to keep that road up, and you got nothing for it. You think the state and their budget problems is not going to make us take this, then I think you probably are fooling yourself. If we take it now and get it completely rebuilt on that road tax money instead of your local property tax money, that's a heck of a lot cheaper than rolling the dice and losing. So doing nothing is worse than not gaining. We will lose, and lose a lot.
Well, plus the development that it will spur, that adds to our tax base. I mean, that's
absolutely. Yeah.
Well, there have been number of attempts to get public feedback on this, and the public feedback is what ultimately convinces me to vote in favor. Last week, I spent a fair amount of time out in the heat, knocking on doors to talk to homeowners, not only in the corridor but also to the north and the south. Also, spent some time talking to business owners on West Broadway. What I found was real concern that the areas north and south of the corridor, they feel that they've been neglected for some time, that they haven't received the attention from the city that they ought to have received, so they're anxious to see something be done. And I agree that should be honored. I heard some real concerns about traffic flow, not only along Avenue A and 2nd, because they fear that a lot of traffic is going to be forced on those, but also the fact that we're going to be restricting traffic on Broadway itself that currently handles about 27,000 vehicles a day. And we're going to put medians and trees and everything else all around, which causes further concern to the business owners. In the staff write-ups, we have some concerns expressed from business owners, have business owners here tonight, and they talked to me about concerns not only about traffic flow, but signage, landscaping, decreased opportunities for parking, all those things that concern businesses as to their ability to not only improve their businesses but also the ability to bring further retail opportunities into West Broadway. And it's those retail opportunities that also help provide jobs and taxable value to the city. So we have to make sure that we're not effectively cutting off their opportunities as well. This plan also does things that these plans normally do in other cities. I got online, and I'll try not to keep you standing up there too long, but I got online and looked at some of the other plans that were done by urban design associates in much larger urban venues such as Chicago, Detroit, Pittsburgh, and a lot of the plans that were produced for those urban environments look a whole lot like the plans that have been designed here for Council Bluffs. With dedicated transit lanes, we have parallel bike paths for commuting bicyclists, and you gotta wonder why the plans end up being the way they are. And the truth is, many times, that these plans are written in order to make the city eligible for state and federal grants. And just like other grants that sometimes government utilizes to get things built, they come with strings attached, which end up having the government entity building things that there's really not a demand for, there's really not a present need for, but that's the requirement of getting the grant. So I understand that, but it is a cause for concern. Having said that, now that I've criticized certain elements of the plan, I do want to congratulate community development. department, because they've done a good job of going through and analyzing what is currently there. They've done a good job of identifying properties for purchase, for clearing, so that they can be made available for redevelopment, and that will open up opportunities. And so I give them the credit that they are due for that work. At the same time, the market analysis for this particular plan suggests that incomes for those living in the western part of the city currently just aren't going to support commercial development that's going to bring the area back. And I profoundly disagree with that sort of sentiment. I think that we have to think very carefully about the people that have already invested their homes and their families and their lives in the western part of the city. And as we move forward, I'm going to be pretty tenacious into making sure that whatever the city does to move forward on this project, that we are doing as much as we possibly can to look out and provide benefit to the people who live there, instead of rebuilding this into something that it's not today.
And acceptance of this plan doesn't give carte blanche to the city to do anything. It will require future actions in the form of resolutions or ordinances that would change existing city laws. And so it's basically a roadmap, outline of what could be.
Not only that, I think our city and its future are as good as Chicago. No offense to Detroit, hopefully better than Detroit. Pittsburgh, certainly. These are sorts of things that there's the demand there. The retiring baby boomers, or like I mentioned this afternoon, millennials now outnumber everybody else, including baby boomers. And this sort of urban type living is where they're going. The question is, do we want to keep more of our young people here or not? We educate them at your expense and mine, and then they go elsewhere. Sometimes in their early 20s people do that, but you'd like to have them think of coming back when they get married and are thinking about kids, and more are doing it. But if we don't do this kind of stuff, they won't. And we had several decades where that happened, and those are decades where we really didn't grow as a community. We stagnated and declined, and this council isn't going to go back to that. We believe in better jobs and increasing opportunities and keeping more people here, and this plan does that.
Let's squeeze Bruce in here before he gets
sorry,
Bob,
forgive me.
Bruce Kelly, 864 McKenzie Avenue. I'll take it back, and that was your secondary highways. State of Iowa says all those were going to be turned over to the counties. The counties fought, they lost.
Mm-hmm.
All the secondary highways are now maintained by the county, and the county had to raise taxes to maintain these roads and everything.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, the state of Iowa, in my opinion, of what I've read, is that either we take this deal on Broadway or we're going to lose it. And we're going to end up maintaining it, and it's going to cost us that $20 million to replace the roads and to maintain it. This is something that was in the newspaper. I don't know how long ago it was that the Iowa, see, that state of Iowa, to keep their road costs down, gets rid of their roads and makes this. So their maintenance on roads is less because they have less roads to maintain. So the county has to pick up the slack. Broadway, the state of Iowa don't want Broadway. They never, and for the last few years. And either we're going to take this money to repay, build it, and this is just the first phase, the 16th. It's going to go all the way out to Iowa West and everything. So I like you to know, either we take it or we lose it. And we're talking probably $50 to $60 million in the long run that we'll have to come up with to replace Broadway all the way through this town.
Good point.
Thank you.
Thank you.
One minor correction. I omitted a city from my list of cities that have adopted similar plans, and that includes Baltimore, and each one of those urban environments is at this time and date virtually bankrupt.
Because of the plan?
Okay. Lenny Scaletta. Lenny Scaletta, 2025 31st Avenue. It's my understanding that that's going to change Broadway into one lane each way instead of two with bicycle shafts?
Absolutely not.
Nope.
Okay, that's what I heard. It looks like the traffic is going to flow okay then,
Lenny,
right?
You got to check your sources because I was the source. Not always the best source. We had 2 years ago a conversation in relation to Broadway, and at the time, the consultant said that Broadway carried 21,000 cars per day, and that that was right on the borderline of three-lane or five-lane. I think the number is 22.5. You need five lanes. The discussion then was if you took Avenue A and made it two-way, you could some traffic that lives north of Broadway would then take Avenue A, would further reduce that. You could do what they called a road diet and shrink the road down to three lanes. And so I reported that meeting when I was running for mayor and made Augie for being, and as somebody wrote in the Voice of the People, this guy's lived here for 58 years and he doesn't realize how busy Broadway is. Where did you get your numbers? Well, you know where we got our numbers? From the DOT website. But they have since amended those numbers. It's 27,000. If this development happens, it will go up rather than down. And so, unfortunately, I admit to being the bad source of information on that particular topic. I've since changed my opinion, so.
Well, I got to understand that because I'm the only one in the world that's never made a mistake. But anyway, that was my concern is the flow of traffic because that would discourage people if you didn't have it. And the bike trails, you got some bike trails that are going to be used 2 or 3 months out of the year. I mean, that's something to take into consideration, and I trust you have. So.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Leanne Hughes, 1420 North 21st. I really want to say thank you to people like Bruce who have done their homework. I went to all the meetings for this, and right from day one, there were 2 or 3 different plans that were laid out about this whole project. And there were hundreds of people, including myself, at these meetings, sitting around tables, answering questions, telling and giving our input, and telling the council and the city what we wanted to see. And they took all the information that we gave them in all of the meetings, and I want to say there was 4, but hundreds of the city citizens of this town were at these meetings, sitting around tables, talking, discussing, looking at the plans, going through each plan, deciding whether we wanted to have one lane on each side or two lanes, or whether we wanted to have a median, whether we wanted to have a median go all the way down Broadway, or if we wanted to have it split so that we could, you know, we all answered all these questions. We, the city, decided about these plans, and I just really appreciate the fact that you guys took our input, you put it together, and now you're going to go forward with that input. And many private citizens, many businesses, many of us who actually took time. And I'll tell you, I work dawn until dark. This is my busy season. I take time to go to these meetings and learn and put my input in. So I just want to appreciate all the people who did come to those meetings and the people who put their input in, and the city council and the development company for listening to what we had to say.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Any other discussion?
I brought with me tonight, in case anybody's interested, and you can look these two over and compare them. I have the first draft of the plan dated 1st of April, and then the final draft dated 19 June. My opinion, not a lot of changes between the two plans, but anybody who wants to see that earlier draft, I'll make it available to you.
John, did you want to?
John Blue, 3409 Avenue C, Council Bluffs. I'm apprehensively excited about the West End project. I live down there. Some of my concerns are, and so, what about the businesses that are already there? You know, are they going to be in jeopardy? I'm talking like Don Brown's Automotive Repair there, Atherton's, who's been there since 1928, and, you know, is this going to affect, how is this going to affect them?
Well, you know, former Councilman Scott Belt always said, I don't have my crystal ball, and yeah. In this case, it's pretty difficult to say. Can we directly affect them through eminent domain? No, Iowa law doesn't allow that. So those businesses continue to operate just as they are, and they're grandfathered in based on when they established their business. One way, potentially, I think, and this is just me spitballing ideas, talking out loud, one way we could adversely affect some of those businesses would be to block the median and not allow left turn access into their business. And that's a potential I think we need to be cognizant of as we go forward. On the other side of the coin, I think we can really help them. One, it's going to improve access to Broadway, because the interstate will now have a full interchange. It's going to make it aesthetically more appealing, which should help their property values when it comes time they want to sell their business. So there are potentials on both sides.
Okay. Only one business I'm concerned about that I don't care what we got to get rid of. Since you tore down Conn's, Romantics sticks out there like a great big sore thumb. I mean, can we arrange a lightning strike or something to hit that building?
It falls into that same category. We do not have eminent domain right.
Yeah. Okay.
Preaching to the choir on that one.
Yeah. I know that they're deep in the lease there. And then I have one other question. Where is River's Edge at? What is the location?
Well, the original name for Hannafin Park was River's Edge Park, and then they expanded the name to be Tom Hannafin's River's Edge Park.
I was sitting here trying to figure out, where is this place at?
Many people also know it as the Playland Park, which was a recreational park for many years, and originally came into the city's possession because it was donated to them by the Dodge Foundation for purposes of having a park.
Okay.
And I'll try and tell you a quick, long story. Meyer Lansky, who along with Lucky Luciano founded the Mafia, Meyer Lansky lived at the Chieftain Hotel where Godfather's used to be up there. He ran a dog track at Playland Park. It was illegal to have pari-mutuel gambling. And so you would buy an ownership interest in the dog. If the dog performed well, the value of the dog went up, and you sold your interest back. If the dog did poorly, the value went down, and you sold it back at a loss. So you weren't gambling. You were just buying an interest in the dog. In order to run that operation, and I think I'm right on this. I may be wrong, but it hasn't ever stopped me before. In order to allow the city fathers to allow Meyer Lansky to run the dog track, he donated a specific amount of the proceeds that built this building. And when they built Hannafin River's Edge Park, they were looking for donors. And if you look at the donor plaque, Meyer Lansky is one of the donors for the, but I've made the donation, but I put it in his name. I wanted somebody to look and go, Meyer Lansky.
I knew about the dog track because my dad and my uncles used to walk dogs down there.
Yeah, a lot of people did, yeah.
So, there you go.
And I heard all that.
You're going to get a boring government.
I heard that story from my dad and my uncles. So. That's
all. That's a great story.
Yeah. Down on the donor panel.
Go to West Broadway in Motion and again, see every stage all the way back to September 14, and make your own mind up and tell us. Like the mayor said, it's a plan. It's not all being done tonight. Far from it. It's a plan, and we want to hear from you. So, but please go take a look so that you know what's being proposed.
Look for the left turn lane in front of the tree in the median. That's what's just more government fun.
Any further discussion? Is all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All the same sign. Madam Clerk.
Resolution 15-205, authorizing the mayor and city clerk to execute an agreement with Rife Construction for the Central Fire Station Window Project.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All the same sign.
Resolution 15-206, authorizing the Department of Parks, Recreation, and Public Property to submit a resource enhancement and protection grant application for the Fairmont Park Woodland Restoration Phase 2 project, and authorizing the mayor to enter into an agreement if approved.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion?
Yet more work at Fairmont Park. I hope folks have gone up there recently to see where they're getting rid of a lot of the so-called invasive trees that have gone in and killed a lot of the original trees and the undergrowth, that's probably the wrong word, of the forests up there, because you'll see that when you first look at it, you think they're tearing half of it down, but no, they're actually restoring it to what it was, which is the oaks and the real trees that were here before other ones blew in from other places as the country started to develop, and are really choking out the new ones, or the original ones, and the view. And this is another plan, along with the splash pad, leveraging a lot of money from all the sources, that please go up there and take a look. It's fantastic.
It does look totally different.
Yeah.
Well, and this is a very competitive grant, so there's no guarantee that we'll receive it. I'll keep my fingers crossed, but I won't hold my breath. But I remain hopeful that we do win out.
Make an application, mm-hmm. So there's no certainty.
Right.
Yeah. Leanne Hughes, 1420 North 21st. I've done some work up there recently. Last year I was there for the first phase to do some work, and I was very skeptical when they started cutting all the trees down. And I was amazed 2 weeks ago when I drove up there and saw the grasses. I didn't have any idea what it was going to look like, and you know, I was very skeptical, but it is really awesome. And the second phase down below, where they're taking all the trees and everything out, it really doesn't look like a lot right now, but wait till next year. I know people are really going to be impressed, because I'm amazed when you go up to the top, as I did a couple weeks ago. So really, it looks really good.
A long neglected
treasure. Thank you guys for doing that.
And thank you. That is exceedingly high praise from a certified arborist, and I genuinely mean that. Thank you.
All right. Any other discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Resolution 15-207, authorizing the mayor and city clerk to execute an agreement with D&D Construction for the Valley View Park Culvert Project.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion?
Just that this is a culvert that if it isn't replaced, it's deteriorated to the point that they'll have to close traffic going across it. It's pretty dire, so.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign.
Resolution 15-208, authorizing the mayor and city clerk to execute an agreement with Bluffs Paving and Utility for the Recreation Complex West Ball Fields Drainage Improvement Project.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Is there discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign.
Applications for permits and cancellations, 6A1, 6B1, and 6C.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Discussion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Madam Clerk, any citizens' requests to be heard?
None received.
Anyone from the audience like to address the council?
Just going to keep a 864 McKenzie Avenue, Bruce Kelly. Keep it in your ear. I don't like bike trails, but I want a bike trail from Fairway to Sims. Thank you.
Thank you.
I hear you.
John Blue, and I still live at 3409 Avenue C. I haven't moved yet. You know, all these plans are all real well and good. I recently completed that Citizens Police Academy thing. Mm-hmm. Enlightening. Man, you get the time, you need to go to this. But made me aware, of course, I listened to all these policemen. We need a new police facility, badly. You know, I know we're hiring, like, I think 6 new police officers. That'll give us 119 police officers, if I remember the count right. Is there a plan somewhere in all this? I know it's going to cost a lot of money, because I've talked to Chief Carmody.
There is a plan in development. They advertise requests for proposal, requests for qualifications. And development teams are currently working on a plan. I think there's maybe 4 or 5 development teams that will then come forward and present their ideas. This city government can spend up to $750,000 on non-essential corporate purpose use without the potential for a reverse referendum. And frankly, a police department cost is somewhere between $17 and $20 million. And so it's a huge number that would have to be bonded for, that then would be subject to a reverse referendum. And so we really need to do our due diligence on this. We really need to be able to make our case to the citizens. We really need to be able to structure the financing so that we can fit those debt repayments back in to a budget that would allow us to maintain a levy at a reasonable rate. And so you're right. I was telling Councilman Ringenberg earlier, I went over for an emergency management meeting 6 months ago. And Wendy Schultz was with me, who used to work in the police department. And we come out of the meeting, and we walk by about 8 people in the hallway who are unrolling butcher paper. And inside the butcher paper is a pair of bloody jeans. And I said, "What is that?" And she said, "Shh, wait till we get out. There is no evidence room where the attorneys can go to sit in privacy and review the evidence that the police department has." I mean, it's dire. And I really want to thank you for bringing up the police academy. I would tell you, I drug my wife to the first meeting, and I didn't ever have to drag her again. It's like 8 months long, and you learn about police work.
It's worth the time.
It's really interesting.
You learn a lot.
She'd let me know on Sunday, you know, Thursday night, we got to go to the police academy.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, it was really interesting, and I always supported our law enforcement, but that really, you know, gets you, you know.
Yeah.
The sheriff moved out of there because he outgrew it.
Yeah.
And it is very small, I mean, I actually just did a tour today.
And their filing area is atrocious.
So we need to look and plan. We need to find other sources of money. $20 million is a lot of money. And hopefully it'll be less than that, but it could be potentially that expensive. So.
Yeah.
Let's write Warren Buffett for some.
There you go.
Yeah, a building that predates DNA being used in crime work routinely, predates computers being on desks or now in our pocket, not fit for purpose anymore.
Al Ruby, 513 North 27th Street, and that is a positive thing. We do need a new police department. There's no doubt about it. City Council Bluffs is growing. That's something we really do need. And to stay on the positive side, you know, we got one of the most important days coming up in November. First of all, we got, as I would say, the Marines, their birthday, but we've also got the parades that's coming up for the veterans. And I'm asking the City of Council Bluffs and the City Council, we need to make sure that the city knows what's going on with this thing, and we need to support this parade. And I think with the council people up here, and I'm asking for you too, Matt, as our mayor, we need to publicize this, get this out, so people know what's going on. If you look the last few years, and I've been in every parade that I can think of, and I'm here also as a Kingsville Riders Honor Guard, And I'm telling you, there's a lot of vets out there that miss the opportunity. And I think it's if the vets and the city council and a few other people get together, get these people out on the streets, let them know who their vets are, and let them know who the council people are, and work together as a group. That's going to be really important this year. And as a Canesville Riders Honor Guard and another guy sitting here, we've been doing that for over a year and a half now. We've done 92 funerals. And a lot of these vets that have been laid to rest, some of them have not had a family, and we've carried the vet and presented a flag to the mistress. This is important. It really is. So I'm asking the city council to get behind us on this, and let's get the people out so they know who their vets are and what it's all about, because if it wasn't for them, we wouldn't be here and you guys wouldn't be sitting there.
Kind of on a related topic that I know you're interested in, I think that starting next week, I've got my fingers crossed, that the bricklayer will be at the Bronze Eagle. The contractor that then will complete the flat work and is the same contractor that's doing Fairmont Park, and we've been in contact with him. He's ready to step in. So hopefully by that November 11th date, we will have brought that long overdue project to completion. So
to a close?
Yeah.
Yeah, it'll be a blessing. But I'm just asking the city council and to get this out. And we've got the gentleman from the Nonpareil, the news. We're asking the Nonpareil, hey, you know what? Take some of your ink, take one big page and say, hey, join the vets on Veterans Day. That's important. It really is. And I hope we got the city's council behind us.
You do.
Thank you.
Would you mind mentioning for the camera when it is so folks might know?
The Marine's birthday is on the 10th, and the Veterans Day, I believe, is on the 11th.
No, the parade's on November 7th.
November Saturday. 7th?
Yeah.
Okay, you were wrong.
Yeah.
The 11th is Veterans Day, but the parade's on.
Yeah, okay, on the 7th.
Parade's on the 7th, okay. Yeah. Let's get people out there.
What time does it start this
10
year?
O'clock,
10 o'clock?
10 o'clock?
I think so.
Okay.
To give an additional plug on that, this is also coming up on the 100th anniversary of the death of General Dodge, and the occasion of his funeral resulted in the largest military parade in the Midwest to date.
Mm-hmm. Really?
Had not been exceeded since. We have managed to secure the caisson that was used to transport his body, and that will we plan on that being in the parade, and we hope to have folks from the Dodge House as a part of that celebration, and we're working on other big things yet to be announced, so details forthcoming. Mm-hmm. And oh, by the way, we're also coming up on the groundbreaking for the Iowa Veterans for the Pottawatomie County Veterans Affairs building. That will be coming along very soon, and I'll be talking to the mayor here very soon with a proposal to bring about a designation of Council Bluffs as a Iowa home base city, and that's something that was authorized by the legislature, has been pushed by the governor to help provide additional opportunities for veterans in the city. And I think that this is something that we can achieve to get that designation and open up some more opportunities to what has historically been underserved portion of our population. So more good things to come.
You know, and that's a blessing. And I tell you, if they do have that case on, you have my number, call us. If there's something that the Riders can do, the Canesville Riders Honor Guard can do to help make this happen, maybe you can do a reenactment of that in part of the parade. Because that is part of our history.
I'm on the parade committee. I'll let them know.
And because if you look on the wall at Cutler O'Neill that day, because Cutler O'Neill is the one that handled that funeral, you'll look and see that caisson is in there, and they're doing that funeral that day. So, you know, that's a lot of things that go on. And, you know, and what really touched my heart, not talk your head off, but what really touched my heart is when we carried a multiple vet. And what I mean by multiple vet, this guy had medals on him. And you can think of, he was a Purple Heart recipient. And not only did he have one, but he had three. And there was nobody left in his heir. He had no kids but his wife. And when we presented, his wife wasn't going to get out of the car because she was too fragile. but she struggled and she got out of that car. And when I turned around to present that flag to take it to the car, to the door, I almost hit her in the head with it, and I really felt bad. But she was so proud of what was taking place. So give us a call. You know.
Thank you so much.
You bet.
I'll help get the word out. I think we've all got Facebook pages. Right. We can put it out on all of our Facebook pages.
We can do reminders at the meeting.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So that,
yep. At each meeting till then, we can do the reminders. And.
I don't have any Facebook page.
Okay, well.
Yes, you do.
You do have one.
Oh, actually, I do.
Maybe do.
You just on that quote, we'll just put it on there for you.
All right. With that, anything from the council? We're adjourned.
At Cantipus Savings Bank, you get personalized customer service like nowhere else, like our travel club.
Come see us, bank with us, and travel with us. Council Bluffs Savings Bank, hometown banking the way it used to be.
The Mid-America Center is the Heartland's premier entertainment and convention center. September 27th, jam with Papa Roach and headliner Five Finger Death Punch. Over at the convention center, July 10th and 11th, British Fest comes to town. Then July 20th through the 26th, see the Nebraska Regional Bridge Tournament. And August 8th and 9th, it's the Spirit of Courage Celebrity Weekend. Remember, the MAC offers free parking for all events. Tickets, information, and more at midamericacenter.com.